Well, good morning, Harvest. How are you today? Good to see you here. And hey, ladies, welcome back from Camp Harvest. That's a pretty cool place, huh? I've spent a lot of my years up at that camp watching God do great things and have so many amazing stories of what took place at Camp Harvest. But this is not one of those stories. Ready for it? So Camp Harvest, we're getting ready for the next group, and man, just so excited to see what the Lord had just completed, and we're like, man, God is alive and at work, and there's a bunch of us, and we have some great people working together and doing this and that all around the court area, and I'm standing looking at the team and like, hey, let's get about this, and let's get about this, and let's get... And the next thing I know is a basketball rim falls on my head. You can all say, ouch. It really hurt. That was the understatement of the day because it didn't just hurt. It buckled my knees to the ground. And then all of a sudden, I see something on my face that isn't sweat. It's a different color. And I realize I am in big trouble. And so I grab my head and I pull it closed. And I'm like, I need what? I need help. I need help. And I am out in the middle of Nowheresville. And I'm like, where do I get help? And I realize that help is not 5 seconds away, 5 minutes away, or 15 minutes away. I've got to get somewhere, and I can't wait to get close to that person who can give me what I need. I need to get close to them so they can give me what I desperately need. Is it very obvious when I get to that person what I'm going to need? Yes. It's very obvious. And so I have to get up and go to get to the place to get close to the person who's going to be able to provide that help that I need. And that's the tension we're going to see right away in this text. But I want you to know this. In this text, you are going to see just Jesus come and see, come close. And when we do that, when we get close to Jesus, he changes everything. He changes everything. And that's something that we can celebrate. That's something we can rejoice in. And I would love for us to be able to see that in this text in Mark chapter 3. I'd invite you to stand to your feet. I'd like to read verses 7 through 12 together. And when we come up to this one phrase, I'd love for all of us to say this phrase out loud. And it's, they came to him. When we get to that phrase, everybody say that out loud. You're going to see it one other time in the text. It's later. And when you get to, when you see that later in a text, just underline it, because that's some really important words inside of this. Verse 7, Jesus withdrew with his disciples to the sea, and a great crowd followed from Galilee to Judea and Jerusalem and Idumea and from beyond the Jordan and from around Tyre and Sidon. When the great crowd heard all that he was doing, they came to him. And he told the disciples to have a boat ready for him because of the crowd, lest they crush him. For he healed many, so that all who had disease pressed around him to touch him. And whenever the unclean spirit saw him, they fell to the ground before him, and they cried out, "You are the Son of God." And he strictly ordered them to not make him known. Let's pray. Father, in this text, we are going to be spending some time looking at what you did to care for people. And as we are looking at what you did so wonderfully, thank you that we can see ourselves today in this text, and that if we come close to you, you change everything. So help us to see clearly who you are today. Help us to see clearly who we are. And help us respond correctly and obediently to your word. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You can have a seat. Come close to Jesus. And yet it seems like right away there's a problem, because what does Jesus do? It says in verse 7, look, Jesus withdrew with his disciples. That doesn't seem like he's getting ready for people to come close to him. He's stepping away. And here's the tension. Here's what we can see. Why did Jesus do that? Look at verse 6 because it really paints the picture for us. Verse 6 says, "And the Pharisees went out immediately, held counsel with the Herodians against him on how to destroy him." You need to know, back in this day, the Herodians were a political group of people that aligned themselves with Rome, and they were very against what Jesus was doing. And there was a group called the Pharisees who were not fans of Jesus either, and they were against Jesus and what he was doing. And the Herodians and the Pharisees, they weren't friends with each other. Matter of fact, they didn't see eye to eye on almost anything, but they have one thing in common, and it's what? We need to destroy Jesus. Wow. I don't know if you've ever had pressure like that. I have never had that in my life, but the pressure of these groups and their intensity of wanting to take Jesus down is palpable. That's why Jesus says it's time to withdraw. Is there a time when he's going to die? Absolutely, but this isn't the time, the place, or the plan that God the Father has for him. And so he withdraws and he says to the disciples, "Let's go to the sea. It's far away." And as they are withdrawing because of this tension, I don't blame him. How many of you think that's a good day off? Yeah? That's good to take that day off. It's time to read the play and go. And maybe some of you were like that this last week. Man, the pressures of life are a little bit crazy, and it's a four-day weekend. So some of you were like, last Friday, let's pick it up and let's leave early so that we don't hit the Chicago traffic. And then your plan didn't quite go as planned. And you didn't leave early, and you left during the worst part of the day, and you got into rush hour, and all these people were on the same road that you were trying to travel to, and all you were trying to do is to withdraw. You were trying to get away so that, well, that's what's going on right here. These people are against him, and they are joining forces to put him down. And while this is going on and Jesus is trying to withdraw, take a look at this map behind me. This map shows us the area, the region of where all these people are coming from. And it said the crowds followed. So imagine Jesus is trying to withdraw, just like you are trying to get away and you get on 294 and you are stuck with traffic. He's trying to withdraw, but people all around him are gathering toward him. Now, this region is not small. It's like 61 hours from the furthest point to get to Jesus by walking. So that's like 8 hours a day, 7 days a week, walking to Jesus, because they knew that if they get to Jesus, he can change the problem, the challenge, the crisis that they're feeling in their life. We got to get to Jesus. They were willing to walk wherever they were at in this region to get to Jesus. And they have one thing in mind. It's not to hear the teachings of Jesus, even though he's a great teacher. They know that he can give them what they need. And it's a change of where they're presently at, or what they're presently feeling, or what they're presently working through. The crisis that is heaviest on them, they know they have to get to Jesus. He can provide everything. Can you see now what Jesus is going to be feeling? Take a look at this picture. This is what I would be feeling. People all over the place. And he is trying to withdraw from those who are against him. And all these other people are coming toward him. For what? For their benefit. I get claustrophobic just looking at that picture. And that's what he felt on that day. And that's why he said, look at verse 10, what it said. It said that they came to him and he told the disciples to what? Have a boat ready. There's the first getaway car in all of Scripture right there. Like, he sees these people and they are coming for change, and he is like, but guess what he doesn't do? Even though he says, get the boat ready, I'm sure it was fire up the motor, whatever they did back in that day. he did not get in that boat. Jesus realized that these people who were coming to him for change, it was real. There was crisis, there was concerns, there was cares. And he stayed there, and it says, and many who had disease and many who had the troubles of life, he stayed there and he did what? He healed them. He gave the appropriate change that they were looking for to have in their life. And maybe it's a little different for us today. Maybe you came in here today and you traveled a distance to get here because you're in a crisis. You're in something in your life that you just need change, and you know that if you can get to Jesus, everything can be better. But you didn't know where to turn, you didn't know who to talk to, but you found yourself here, and maybe it's in finances. My financial world is in a wreck right now. Maybe it's something in your family. I came to church today because I just need the hope of Jesus and my family. We're wrestling, we're struggling. Maybe it's at work. Maybe it's something that you've kept secret. Maybe it's like Kurt that you saw in the baptism today, who had a secret sin that was so infectious inside of him in such a terrible way, and the effects were widespread. And he just needed a change. And he went to Jesus. And Jesus is the only one who can change like that. He can change you. Kurt on that day had some radical change because Jesus came in. Sometimes we have a crisis in our life and we think that we're going to get help for that crisis. We need Jesus to change that, but you might find something very different to be the reality, is that that's just the surface, and Jesus maybe needs to be your savior. Maybe you came in here today because of a crisis. Maybe you came in here because you saw something that needed to be changed, but you've never turned to Jesus. The good news is this: in Kurt's life, he got low real quick. He was down on the cement floor and he called out to Jesus. Jesus, please forgive me for my sin. Please enter my life, be my savior. And guess what Jesus will do? He will radically change you. He gives that hope. He gives a hope for the sinner to have salvation, to be eternally changed, and it will change your perspective for all of life. He will help us in our times, just like these people who are willing to travel so far to get to Jesus because of the needs that they had in front of them. Jesus, if we come to him, he can make the change. When you come close to Jesus, everything changes. That's the good news. When my head was split open, I couldn't get to that emergency room fast enough. Can you just go a little faster? Can we get there? And I'm sure that that crowd was like, can we pick up the pace a little bit so that we can get to Jesus? I want you to know that however you came in this room this morning, in whatever crisis and whatever crossroads you're at, Jesus is available for you. And maybe it's your day to come before Jesus and to pray and say, Jesus, I just need you to enter my life for the first time, or this crisis in my life, I just need you to help this be different than what it is. He promises to meet us right where we are. He promises to stick around. He's not going to get down a boat and leave. He's going to stay. He's going to be right there with you. Proximity with Jesus is everything. Let's get there. Number two, come close because Jesus wants a relationship with you. Verses 13 through 15. And he went up to the mountain, and he called to him those whom he desired, and they came to him. And he appointed 12, whom he also named apostles, so that they might be with him and might send them out to preach and have authority to cast out demons. Well, come close to Jesus, he wants to change you. Come close to Jesus, he wants a relationship with you. Such an amazing text. It's so easy for us to then jump ahead to see who the 12 were. Let's not miss the first part of this. And he came to the mountain and he called those whom he desired, and they came to him. I love the fact that now he's spent time with these people who came to him, and he met with them and he gave change to them. And now he says, okay, it's time to go to the mountain. It's a time to, and this is much like the chapter 2 where he went to a desolate place and he prayed to the Father. If you take a look at the parallel passage in Luke chapter 6, you will find that it says in there that he on this day went to the mountain and he prayed to God. Mark just uses fewer words. Luke paints a little broader picture of it. It's the same day, the same thing. He's going to the mountain. He's taking those who are closest to him. It's more than 12. We see the 12, but it's he picks those who he desired, and then he appoints these apostles. But he's got these who are closest to him. And so let's take a look at that. One, he takes them to a mountain. In the Old Testament, when Jesus said, he's telling them, let's go to the mountain. And it was a flashback for them to think about mountain. We're going there. That's to hear a word from God. Moses, when God wanted to speak to him at Sinai, went up into the mountain and God spoke to him. He spoke to him in Exodus. He spoke to him in Numbers. He spoke to him in Deuteronomy. One time he was with Joshua. They went to the mountain. God had an interaction with him. And I think this passage here, Jesus is saying, we tried to withdraw from those who were trying to bring harm, and we were able to meet the needs of those who came who needed change. And now it's time to withdraw. It's time to go to the mountain, to hear from the Lord, to be refreshed. And don't miss this. He brought those who were closest with him. He desired a certain group to join him. Why? Because this group of people, they breathed life into him. They were some people who were refreshing to him. These were people who put wind in his sail. These are people who would come alongside and partner with him. These were really special people to Jesus. And when you take a look at this, they got to the mountain. They prayed. And they spent time together. Can you imagine what that must look like? I think we can. Harvest is all about small groups. It's those who are closest who can breathe life into us, who can help us bear one another's burdens, who can do care with each other, encouragement with each other, who can spur one another on toward love and good deeds. That's what we have in small groups. And if you're not in a group like that and you're not experiencing community or connection like that, I would invite you to that because Jesus models this right here. He did life with those who were close to him and they encouraged him. They poured into him. Jesus needed that at this time and he had that with this group. And then it says he appointed these 12 whom he named apostles. That's their office. So that they might, don't miss this. Here's what I missed the first time through on this. He gave them three things to do. And I jumped right to the task side, and maybe you're like that. What did he ask them to do? To preach and have authority over the demons. Don't miss the first part. Take a look at it. It said that he, what? That they might be with him. What a great invitation. Jesus could have asked them to do anything, and he says, hey guys, as we get to the mountain, I just want you to be with me. That's not a conversation that is very shallow. We're talking about the superficial things of the day. I am sure that conversation looked a lot like what we have in small groups, and we're talking about heart things, and we're talking about what is it that's deep and meaningful to you. And I'm sure Jesus was inviting them to, what are some of the things that are troubling to you? What are some of the things that we can pour into and encourage one another? Be with him. Spend time with him, being filled with him before he asks you to step out and do these things with Jesus. Let's figure out how we can be filled up before we go out. And I'd like you to write three things down. And I'd love for that to be the goal this week, for us to take a look at, are these happening in our life? And if they're not, would you take the challenge of doing all three of these things this week? I want us as a church to be filled with Jesus. He asks these 12 before they go out to do this. And the first thing I'd like you to write down is come up with a plan of how you're going to spend your time with Jesus. Come up with a plan. You know, there's so many reading plans out there, and I'm a big fan of having a Bible reading plan, but I'm not a big fan of what happens and sometimes what I hear. You miss a couple days, and then what happens when you get back to it? You're so concerned about making up what you didn't read that you're more about getting the checklist off the plan than you are meeting with the person and the power of that man. You are going to the Word to spend time with the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Your plan isn't to go through a checklist or go through just a reading plan. Your plan is to be enriched and refreshed and renewed and challenged, and that the Lord would speak something directly to you. Your plan. It's so important. I can just tell you a little bit of what Sherry and I have done over the last couple months. We've chosen a book of the Bible. We chose to read the book of Ephesians every day for a month. Every chapter, every day, read it and talk about it. We've chosen another book of the Bible, another month, and read that every day. Why? Because we want Jesus to saturate us from the Word of God so that we're ready to go out, but we have to be filled with. I love plans, but inside your plan, if it misses a day, don't be so concerned about the plan, but I will say, come up with a plan. And figure it out today so that when you wake up tomorrow, here's my plan. I'm getting in the Word this way. I'm going to let the Lord fill me in this way. I would encourage you to pick a little book of the Bible and figure out how to dissect that and digest that and just be saturated in that. Do that for a month. But start with just this week. Pick a plan with Jesus and a time with Jesus. A time with Jesus. For Sherry and I, it's in the morning. We get up a little bit earlier, and we spend some time, and we read the Word of God. We have a certain time that we do that. But isn't there sometimes a temptation, maybe you don't face, but I face, there's that thing on our clocks called what? Snooze? How many of you have ever hit the snooze? Am I the, okay. So when you hit the snooze on the alarm clock, what tends to happen to the morning? It gets a little more chaotic, right? It gets a little more like, whoo, okay. How about another nine? Is yours 9 minutes? Mine's nine. Like, I don't know why it's 9 minutes. But 9 minutes in that, and then you've got nine less minutes to go about your morning routine. What usually happens when that 9 minutes and another 9 minutes, what usually, for our home, I can tell you that, you feel like it's a little bit cramped, and you feel like, and you're probably not going to miss your shower, and you're probably not going to miss shaving, and you're probably not going to miss getting yourself together. So what can become like a cram session? Maybe your time with the Lord. And so think about the time that you're going to do this and be after it with everything you have. Pick a time and make that something that's just, this is the plan, this is the time, and we're going to be after this. Don't make it like the coach who calls the 30-second timeout to get his team over to give them four instructions and then they go out and you're not being filled in the way that you need that. Let's be a church. Let's be a people that's about, I can't wait to get into the Word with a plan and at a certain time so that the Lord can really fill me. And here's the last thing. Find a place. Sherry and I have a little place in our home. If you go to it, you'll see these two chairs. And that's where we go. And that's where we sit down. That's where we read. And that's where we have as a place, a plan, and a time to spend with the Lord. And that time should be intimate. That time should be purposeful. That time should be, Lord, enlighten me, show me, reveal to me. Show me the areas where I need to confess and repent. Show me the areas that I need to be open and honest and humble and teachable. Lord, make this plan and time and place something that really fills me, because I know what you're asking me to do. You're asking me then to leave my home and to go out to accomplish the day. So that leads us to the second thing. He says, be with me, and then he says, preach the good news. When you think about these people that he's invited with him, how many of these people do you think have Bible degrees? Anybody? When you look at that list a little bit later, and you'll see like, none of these people have Bible degrees. None of these people have seminary degrees. None of these people were like, hey, I got to get to the next workshop. I got to get to the next class before I go out and do this. We need to be filled with Jesus and then immediately ready to go for Jesus. And he says, be with me. We're going to preach the gospel, and here's the authority that you have. What is the gospel? Preach the gospel, he says. Preach it. It's not for just the one who is in this position right here. We get to do it every day. We get to share the good news of Jesus. We get to be the ones who, with a person who's in crisis or challenge or in a crossroads of life, we can bring hope. And that's what Jesus is saying. We're going to go out and give people hope. We're going to point people to the one, the true God. We're going to point the way of salvation, the gospel. We're born dead in our sin, but God, who loved us so much that he sent Jesus to this earth to die on the cross, to rise again the third day, that we might be forgiven of our sins, that we might have hope in Jesus. That's what we get to share. That's the conversations we should be having with people who are right in front of us. We are the ones sent out. And if we confess with our mouth Jesus as Lord and believe that God raised him from the dead, we will be saved. What's the gospel? It's people need to hear it. I too often believe that we put ourselves on the sidelines because we think we have to have just a little bit more before I go. And I just want to encourage you, the little bit more before you go is that time that you spend in the Word, letting him saturate our life, and then we get to go. So let's be about this week looking for ways that God can fill us, a plan, a place, and a time so that we're ready to go. Okay, that's what we're going to try this week. Let's get after it with everything we have. The third thing here, come close because Jesus wants to send you. Verses 16 through 19. Verses 16 through 19. In this, you will find a list. It's a list of people, and so let's look at that together. He appointed the 12, Simon, whom he gave the name Peter, James, the son of Zebedee, and John, the brother of James. They're called the sons of thunder. Can't imagine what that home must have looked like. But Andrew and Philip and Bartholomew and Matthew and Thomas and James, the son of Alphaeus and Thaddeus and Simon the Zealot and Judas Iscariot, who betrayed him. When you look at these names, there's some of them that stick out more than others. But I want you to know that if you look in the Gospels, it's the same 12 names. Some of them have double names, which can sometimes be a little confusing. But it's the same 12 that you'll read in each one of the Gospels that God chose to be his apostles. And we can think, man, how did he pick these guys? That's a great question. How does the Lord look at us today? Well, here's what I want him to see in us, because I think he saw in this little motley crew. He saw hearts that were tender toward him. He saw lives that were changed. He saw lives that were ready. He saw lives that were willing. He saw lives that were eager to be about the work that God was calling him to do. These people were ready. And we get the chance today to do that as well. We often think of Peter, James, and John. We think about Matthew, the tax collector. We hear stories of Thomas. We don't hear much about these other ones, and so there's a couple takeaways I thought that we could come up with from a list like this in front of us. What are some things that you and I should be thinking about and putting ourselves into this text? The first thing, we don't need previous experience to have a profound impact on those around us. We don't need to have previous experience to have a profound impact. Simon the Zealot? Matthew the tax collector, Peter the fisherman? James and John, the sons of thunder? It sounds like a very diverse group of people that God is bringing before him to do what? Be filled and then ready to go out? Wow. When I look around this room today, I see very different people in this room. So many people with different backgrounds, cultural backgrounds, socioeconomic backgrounds. How you came to Christ, and maybe some of those who haven't yet. But I see that God can use each one of us. He started with these 12, and the word permeated and spread. And we get the chance now to take that same gospel and allow it to spread. First be filled, then go. First be filled, then go. And when you come to Jesus, everything changes. Second thing, God has equipped and empowered you to share the gospel. How many of you ever get nervous in sharing the gospel? Anybody? Maybe just me? How many of you think, man, if I do that, maybe there might be some negative repercussions for that? You ever think that? How many of you ever think like, man, maybe I do need to know just a little bit more before I share? Yeah, I think we all find ourselves in that. And yet I want you to know that when Jesus fills us, he's giving us what we need to share the good news of the gospel. And these men didn't have any previous experience, but they believed that the Spirit of the living God was inside and ready to empower and equip them for what was in front of them right then and there, and they spread the word. So many different backgrounds, I can't imagine these guys were like hanging out with each other before Jesus called them. They probably looked at each other and maybe even had some disdain toward each other because of who they were before Christ. But God chose to use them. I think about so many different people. I went to a football game the other night. It was Northwestern played this other team. And this other team absolutely trounced Northwestern. Sorry, Northwestern fans. It was ugly. But while we were at the game, it was really interesting to watch these men come on the field. There were some guys, they looked really fast as they came onto the field. I'm like, whoa, can't wait to see what they're going to do. And then there were some other guys that, they were big. I mean, they were like mountains. They definitely had an assignment that was different than that guy who had fast legs. And then as they're hanging out on the sidelines a little bit, you could tell there's one who's going to be throwing a lot. And you could tell there's going to be one who's going to be getting the ball and he's going to be running with it. And you could tell there's going to be others that are going to catch the ball and they are skilled. Each one of them had different skills. And as they went out on the field, they were all aligned with the plan that was in front of them. They had a plan to go into the game, and then they did the game. And as they went back into the tunnel after the game was over, I am sure there was a time of celebration for one team. I'm sure there was a time of correction and equipping and thinking about what needs to change or how do we get ready for the next thing, because they're all going to come out the next week and have an opponent in front of them. And they're going to prepare themselves for that day. And I think about what we get to do with so many different types of backgrounds and personalities and places of employment and homes that we have, that we get to do this together as a church. We get to align ourselves with Jesus Christ. We get to align ourselves with being filled with him. And then we get to take this and we get to go out and then we get to come back to Jesus. And then we get to go out and we get to work together in a way that Jesus is glorified. His kingdom is expanded with what he's going to do, because when you come close with Jesus, everything changes. I think about us as a church today. The third thing I'd love for us to walk away with is we're called to go. This week, I'd like us to not just be filled using those three things that are important, but I'd like us to think about who is it that we know that's in a crisis? Who is it that we know that's experiencing a challenge? And maybe they don't know Jesus, but maybe you just walk up to them and say, I'm praying for you, and Jesus loves you. Maybe that's the starting of what you can do this week in a conversation that lets people know that you know who Jesus is, and Jesus is the one that you're leaning on. Jesus is the one that you're looking to. Jesus is the one that you're representing. And we as a church need to be filled, and then we as a church need to go. And we've all got people in front of us that we can minister to and care for and be about this week, doing the work of the Lord. So which one do you find yourself needing to come to Jesus today that he can change everything? There's three circles that are going to come up on the screen. The first one is, do you need to like come to Jesus and believe that he can change everything by being with Jesus? Or do you need to come to Jesus today and call out to him and ask him to do the second circle, to be more present by being in community, being filled? Or do you need to have this third circle? Do you need to be like, I need to commit to the Lord that I will be a person who's willing to be not just filled, but then sent out for him? Because when we have all three of these working together, there's a little spot that fills in. And that's the sweet spot. That's the spot that Jesus wants us to be. That's total dependence. You know, I got to tell you, when I went to the hospital on that day, they didn't stitch my head back together. They had to use some big, nasty staples. And they stapled my head closed. I was so happy when they did that. There was relief. They changed my problem. You know what they didn't do that day? They didn't invite me to stay. They didn't say, hey, if you want to hang out here for a couple hours, they're like, okay, you're good to go. When Jesus changes you, he says, I'm enabling you, I'm equipping you, I'm empowering you. And you know what? I got to go back to the camp on that day and to get about whatever the Lord had in front of me to do. Hey, church, I don't know what it is or where you find yourself today, but I would love for us to be a church that's spirit-led and spirit-dependent, and that we would be a people who respond in prayer. And so if you're here today and you're like, I just need to meet this Jesus, that he can change the situation I'm in, I'd invite you to come to the front and pray. If you're like, I just need Jesus because I need closer relationship with him, it isn't what it should be, and I'm going to go after that being filled part this week, but I just want to bring this to Jesus, I want to invite you to come forward and pray. Or maybe it's, I want to be seeing Jesus really empowering and giving me the opportunity to spread his word. I want you to come forward and just pray and like, Lord Jesus, give me the power to do that this week. Let's be a church that's dependent upon Jesus, because when we come to him, everything changes. So our worship team is going to lead us in a song, and if you want to come forward and just pray, I'd encourage you to do that. So let's stand to our feet and sing this song.